It all started when I started going to my teacher, my guru, Mr. Ramachandran's house. I'm a student of painting. I studied at the Jamia Millia Islamia, and Mr. Ramachandran was my teacher there. When I finished graduation, I missed to have him around. I missed these regular meetings with him, and I knew I wanted to meet him more. So I started going to his house, where I was welcomed by him and his wife, Jameli Auntie, as I lovingly called her. Those conversations were not just about art, but about philosophy, religion, architecture, parenting, his teacher, Ram Kenkar Bej, his days in Shantiniketan, his days in Kerala, anything and everything. I would go back home and start penning it all in my diary at night, and sometimes as early as when I would head back the auto, I would make notes, so I don't forget a nugget in my exhilaration. And I realized I wanted to archive and document my guru. I went back to my parents one day and I said, please help me get a camera, a still camera, a video camera, and a dictaphone, because I want to document my teacher. And I have a profession. Painting is not a cheap profession. It's an expensive pursuit. And at that time, painting did not really have so many commercials as it does now. But my parents never once said no. They willingly gave me my tools because they saw passion in me, and they let me and indulged me with all that I needed. It's a big lesson in parenting, I feel. If your child is passionate about something, give them that indulgence they need. The book has yet to happen. 30 years hence, I'm still documenting him. And someday I hope I can give it back as an homage to my parents for whatever they did for me. When I was photographing him, I started becoming very comfortable with the idea of a camera. The camera became a friend, almost like a Siamese twin, like a companion. I would take my camera to artist studios to photograph them in their studios while they were installing shows, at dinners and lunches, everywhere. I was mad, I was passionate. And if you ask me, what was I doing with this? I had no idea. I had no plan. I was just working. And I'm reminded of Rumi, in hindsight. That time, I didn't know Rumi. When Rumi says, start walking and you'll find the path, I was walking. I didn't know what my path is. Something to keep in mind. You don't have to know the path every time. Start walking. I was walking and I didn't know the path. I'm also reminded of the shloka in Bhagavad Gita, Karmane vadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachanah. Start doing your work. Don't think of results. Don't get attached to the results. I had not any idea what I will do with this photography, which had now become like a project. I was one day invited to show my photographs to a very distinguished art audience, and I was very nervous because till now I had shown only my paintings, about which I was very confident. And when I was showing it, I realized, and the art world realized, that Manisha has made this big project of photographing fellow artists in their studios completely on her own all these years. That was something which gave me a lot of confidence as well. And I felt that follow your heart, follow the soft knocks on your heart before the mind says, no, 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 don't do it. Follow those soft knocks. Go ahead and do what your heart is saying. It was at that time when I was invited by my friend Bhavna Kakkar, who is an editor and publisher of India's leading art magazine, now Take On Art. She was just beginning her magazine, and she asked me to start writing a photo essay on my photography. And I had never written in my life, and that's exactly what I told her. I said, I've never written. And she said very confidently, go ahead, try, I'm sure you can do it. I tried. Listen. I tried. And I started being able to write. I took the help of my editor, mother-in-law, and my husband, and the few photo essays I managed to do. Till one day, I had a block because they were both traveling. And I remember speaking to my guru, Mr. Ramachandran, and he said those magic words which I'd like to share with you. He said, you've always photographed like a painter. Why aren't you writing like a painter? And that was it. Those words stay with me. I love writing, I take on writing assignments, and I do it with confidence. But the learning in that was that to be surrounded by friends who believe in you, who prod you, who tell you to do things which you don't know about yourself, I didn't know I could write. She helped me explore the idea, and most important, I took it on. I could have failed, which is okay, but I decided to do it. So surround yourself with the likes of, in my case, my guru and my friends, who helped me find aspects of me which I didn't know about myself. While I was photographing Indian artists, I also started photographing Pakistani artists who used to come to India to have shows. And a lot of them are very dear friends. I started nursing the desire to photograph Pakistani artists in Pakistan. And why Pakistan, you would ask me? Because both my parents were in that part of the land before India became partitioned. My mother is from Quetta and my father is from Sargodha. And my entire childhood, my bedtime stories are about home, their home there, and they still call it home, which is beautiful. Even now, when my brother and I sit with them over dinner or lunches, they speak about Pakistan as their home. That's so special. And therefore, I wanted to visit Pakistan. And it's almost like when you want to do something heartfelt and you vocalize it to the universe is generous. I was asked by a friend on a phone call from Karachi saying, Manisha, we'd like to have a show of your paintings. Would you come? And I said, yes, of course, I'll come. I packed my bags and a few months I was in Karachi for the most amazing, beautiful evening an artist could ask for. I had people, friends I was meeting after almost 14 years, and there were people from all walks of life, from near and far. They came to meet the Dilli Wali. One particular artist I still remember, the Sadduk Suhail, he was in his late 80s, he had a broken foot, he climbed 2 flights of steps, held my hand and said, I've just come to meet you because you're from India. That's the love I got in Pakistan. The next few days, my 3 messiahs, Abid Merchant of Sanat Gallery, Mohammed Zishan, and Ruhi Ahmed, both of whom I had met in India 14 years ago for the SARC art camp, which was organized by Sanjeev Bhargav of Seher, and God bless him for that, because I won't be standing here if he hadn't introduced me to those wonderful friends and organized an art camp. They took me to artist studios in Karachi. I met artists over cups of tea and coffee, and lots of conversations happened. And I realized most of the conversations were not about art. Interestingly, they were about partition because a lot of artists had an India connect. Their parents had come from India to Pakistan. And somehow that changed everything for me. Of course, I was photographing them, but the stories were so fragile and poignant. One such story was of my own friend, Ruhi Ahmed, with whom I was sitting on her Barsati studio on a sunny winter afternoon. And she was showing me her beautiful works. They were very poignant works of her parents. She had lost both her parents, and those works were about her loving lost parents. And in the back, we heard the azan from a nearby mosque. And she looked at me with moist eyes, and she held my hand and said, my parents are from India. And I held them tightly back, and I said, and mine are from here. And we both cried. And I think when we were crying, that was a time my project was germinating, the seeds were germinating at that time, I feel. After that, the following year, I went to Lahore, where my friends R.M. Naeem, Waseem Ahmed, and my artist couple of friends, Aisha and Imran, really helped me in giving me ideas and connecting people. In fact, Aisha and Imran physically helped me when I had to put up a show the following year. In Lahore again, I had this one beautiful meeting with an artist. I entered his studio. It was a 20 feet long wall with a very visible Hindu merchant, and surrounding him were Muslim and Hindu employees. And I asked him, tell me about this photograph. And he said, both my grandmothers are Hindus. So whenever I come to my studio, I want to be with them life size. I want to live the part of history which is slowly ebbing away from my life. I came back to India in a very, very inspired, beautiful, fragile state, and I wanted to do something. I didn't know what to do, but I wanted to do something. And my mother says in Punjabi, ki tumhe rab ne karaya hai project. God has made you do this project. And I really feel I was the instrument for this project to happen. I remember the day I got this thought, why don't you bring it all together? And I decided to send my Indian friends who I had photographed, some of them moons ago, because the project is 16 years old. I sent them WhatsApp messages asking them if they have a connect with partition. And I chose Sindhi and Punjabi surnames from my entire list of artists. And within seconds, I started getting responses. Some sent photographs of their old Haveli, some sent letters of their parents, some sent photographs of their parents, grandparents. It was beautiful. And that's when I said, let me now connect with my Pakistani friends. And here I was on WhatsApp, a 6-lane virtual highway with no barriers, no borders, no visas required. I sent them messages and asked them to write to me. And within seconds, days, months, I was flooded with the most amazing stories. And I was compiling 47 stories of artists from India and Pakistan. It wasn't easy. It was not a roller coaster ride. I had friends and I had artists who didn't want to be part of my project. I felt rejection because I felt they're doubting my integrity. I'm a fellow peer. Why shouldn't they give it? I don't have an ulterior motive. Some had good reasons, some I felt didn't, but that was my judgment. But I persisted. I persisted, I had passion. I was so convinced that I could literally take out the salt from the seawater. That was my conviction. And that's something to keep in mind. When you like something, when you want to do something, just be convinced and the world will help. And that's what happened. I started doing that, in fact, when some of them saw the project which is currently on as an invited collateral at the Kochi Biennale, they came up to me and said, Manisha, this is a beautiful project. We love it. We couldn't respond to you because we weren't sure. But now if you want to continue, which I do, we'd like to be part of it. It helped. I felt very gratified, and at the same time, I felt that I didn't let the rejection put me down. I would like to thank Salima Hashmi, who has worked ceaselessly towards Indo-Pak art relations. She is the voice of the culture in Pakistan, and she's the daughter of the famous poet Faiz Ahmad Faiz. And I was traveling with her to Lahore from Delhi, and she told me on flight that my father always said, make friends. And I said to myself, I've made friends, lots of friends, at least 47, because I have 47 stories. And Postcards of Home was born, I feel. That's when it was born. And when I made the project, I feel almost the universe decided to become generous. I was invited to show my project at the Lahore Biennale, in the walled city of Lahore. One had to actually cross Delhi Gate to come into my project. It was so magical. I decided to put postcards of Indian and Pakistani artists in sacks of wheat. One sack was leaning against the other. Why wheat? Because wheat is the staple diet of both the Punjabs. Wheat also means kanak in Punjabi, a word my parents still use, and I heard it used amongst the elders in Lahore. The youngsters don't use that word. And I decided to put, and of course, kanak also means gold. So I decided to use sacks filled with golden wheat to the brim and have them lean against each other, in which there were postcards of India and Pakistan. And there was a trail of these sacks, so people could actually walk across, pick up one or all postcards. I felt this leaning for love is something we can learn from in relationships, in states, in nations, to be complete and yet lean against each other for love. While people were walking across the sacks in the walled city of Lahore, the elders would look at me, read the card, some would cry because memories came surging, some would just hug me. The youngsters would just ask me about myself, about India, and of course, Bollywood. After that, I was invited to show the project at Lahore again, at the Fairs Festival. I decided to ask my friend and curator, Ali Raza, to curate my project. And he did a fantastic curation. He decided to hang 47 cards from a mobile. And on the floor, he stacked 47 sets of cards in a circle. Everyone had to bend 47 times to pick up the cards to take them home. An homage to the year of India's partition. And this orchestrated brilliance, this orchestrated circumambulation of the picking up of the cards became akin to a spiritual ritual. I realized after I came back to India that the project is so dear to me, and I shared it with a friend I respected, and he brought so much more life to it. He brought so much more energy to it. And I felt the learning was that when you hold something, it stagnates. If it's yours, give it to people. They'll find new ways to do it. They'll give it a bigger reason to evolve and to grow. There were moments when I didn't have any money, and some dear friends said, we'll give it to you. But I have to thank the Kirannada Museum and Anita Lal of Good Earth, who generously supported me so I could show my project both at Lahore and currently at Kochi Biennale. Towards the end, I would like to give one incident, which is nothing to do with the project, but it moved me when I was in Lahore. So I was showing my project in the walled city of Lahore, and my friend had said, if you get time, look up my mother's house. She's 80 plus, and she left that house when she was 8. I Googled, and I realized her house is somewhere around, and I had the time. So the next day, I went looking for her house. It took me 3.5 hours. The address was Kui Veda. Kui means well, Veda means courtyard. I walked 3.5 hours, and lots of well-wishers en route eventually took me to Kui Veda, the courtyard where the well is. But when I reached Kui Veda, 1812, the house, was not there. Instead, a road had been cut, and there was another building, very new, and an old resident said that it had been broken long ago. And I was so depressed, and I said, my God, it's a waste of a day. What have I done? I sent photographs and the video to my friend, who showed it to his mother and her brother, and they were ecstatic. They said, a house. They found a house. And that's when I realized, I'd like to say that project is something I've given birth to, but the project is like a wise child that's given me so much learning. When I heard that statement, I realized my project is not about India-Pakistan, it's not about borders, it's about home. What does a house entail to become a home? Not four walls and a ceiling, but a lot of love, the joy of smells of flowers, seasons, fruits. Some of us are living in homes and we are displaced because at home is no longer a home. We are trapped in the same home because it's no longer a home for us. What is it we need to do to make each day special? I think we need to savor each day with our friends, with the flowers, with the seasons, with mangoes, with poetry. If we aren't doing that, something's wrong. And if we are doing that, we're on the right track. I carry a postcard in my heart every day in hope that one day I'm able to have this conversation with my children. But just today I'm going to catch the morning ardas at the Golden Temple. And then I'll walk across to Wagha and go to Liberty Market to do some shopping and have lunch with my friends in Lahore. And then I will walk across to Andaz restaurant, which is near the Badshahi Mosque, climb up the steps, get Nihari, so we can have Nihari for dinner, the four of us in Gurgaon. Inshallah, that day will happen. Thank you.